This program replaces the Bay Area LASER program, where LASER stands for Leonardo Art Science Evening Rendezvous. It's not a physical laser, so I call them the LAST Dialogues, where LAST stands for Life, Art, Science, and Tech. Go to lasertalks.com if you want to see the ones we've had before. We've had quite a few since June, ranging from topics ranging from COVID to artificial intelligence, and of course, art. Next, before I introduce tonight's dialogue, next on October 1st, we'll have three artist talks, what I think are very unusual topics for artists. And on October 15, we'll have two talks related to the pandemic, one about pandemic resilience and one about ethics. Now about tonight's program. Brief introduction. You can find Professor Harrison's bio if you go to lasertalks.com. There's a link to her webpage. You can find out everything about her. She's professor of energy resources engineering at Stanford, and she's a senior fellow of the Precourt Institute for Energy and the former director of the Institute for Computational, what's it called, computational? I see.
Computational and mathematical engineering.
Yeah. At Stanford. Among other things, one thing we will have to remember to discuss at the very end, she's also the co-founder of the Global Women in Data Science. Is it a conference? Is it a...
It's a movement, we say.
It's a movement. Okay, we'll get there.
Yeah.
We'll get there. Audience, if you have any questions, please post them in the Q&A. Tend not to read the chat when I'm live discussing. But I will check the Q&A, and you're very welcome to join the conversation. This is really a fireside chat. There's no slide presentation. So Margot has presented before at the laser, at the physical lasers, and one of her talks on computational math, in my opinion, was one of the best talks we've had in those 12 years. And I think there's a video on YouTube somewhere. And so I wanted her to talk again about computational math in general and about her multiple interests. But then it became even more interesting because I noticed that the last 6 months or maybe a year, just about everybody we talked to was using computational math, sometimes explicitly and sometimes indirectly. You know, they start talking about the data and algorithm and so on and so on. And this was, you know, the epidemiologist, it was the artist, the neuroscientist, and so on. So it looks like computational math is everywhere. So I thought, and then maybe we'll talk a little bit about politics, you know, Russian hackers interference in US elections, China's use of big data to control domestic public opinion. So it's literally everywhere. So I thought it was interesting to have a discussion, casual discussion, but it's everywhere. So first of all, I would like Margot to introduce the topic. What is computational math? What's different from traditional math? And why is it everywhere? Why is it so powerful and ubiquitous in our age?
Right. Well, thanks, Piero. And before I start, I just wanted to thank everybody for joining right now and for everybody who sees this later on. It's just wonderful to be here, Piero. And I'm glad that we can have a little back and forth instead of a presentation, because I've been Zooming all day since 9. And so I'm happy to just chat instead of giving a lecture. Let me just start by saying that I started in computational mathematics in the 80s, and this is when I started my undergraduate degree program. So I've been in this field myself for nearly 40 years. And at that time, I was already convinced that computational mathematics was everywhere. And this is one of the reasons why I actually started studying it. So in computational mathematics, we are using computer models or mathematical models that we then solve on the computer to analyze and observe systems that we're interested in. So they could be physical systems, could be engineering processes, natural processes, human processes. So we could be interested in human models of human behavior that we're then writing a mathematical model for that we could analyze in more traditional mathematics, or we could try to compute and very often approximate. So sometimes people think about computational mathematics as the field that simulates, approximates, optimizes and helps design problems or predict out. So it's a very applied area of mathematics where you're really you're building the tools that you can use then to observe, analyze, predict out or make decisions. And this is what always really attracted me. So fields in, if you look at computational mathematics as a whole, there's so many different subfields in it. So one subfield, for example, would be decision-making processes. So optimization, for example. Another field could be data science. I see data science and everything to do with data-driven decision-making or data-based modeling also as a field of computational mathematics. You're using mathematics tools and you're using a computer to help solve problems. My own background actually was from more traditional engineering. So I started as an engineer training and then really discovered this field of computational engineering, of computational mathematics as I was going along, because I realized that I wasn't as interested in building a system. For example, at that time, in electrical engineering or mechanical engineering, you could really be in the build phase. But I was really interested in writing for the processes of my passion, which were then fluid dynamics processes of building, virtual laboratories to observe and understand things a little bit better. So it's an incredibly rich field that is really everywhere. And it's interesting to see how gradually over the decades that I've observed this, computational mathematics has penetrated all areas. And you're asking why that is. Well, it's always a combination of various things. One of the reasons, of course, is more and more people are trained in this now. So compared to when I was a student, there are many, many more students choosing this area to train in. And then, of course, then they go and into industry and introduce industry and government labs and so on to new tools. And so it becomes more popular and it sort of perpetuates. The other reason is, which is what we're seeing right now also with data science and artificial intelligence to some extent and deep learning, is we've gone through several of these periods. And the first period, I think, was about 25 years ago when there was this, that's the term they use now, democratization of the field, in that software became available to people. So black boxes were written and software became available and was shared to public domain software. Computer tools, so software packages that were written by whole groups of people, you can contribute to, which happens a lot now, and people were freely sharing. And so when you reach that stage in the field, you see this proliferation of applications. And in computational mathematics, we had this huge surge around 25 years ago when tools for optimizing, simulating, became available to large parts of the population, whereas before they were really only available in academia and maybe in the national laboratories and some of the big companies, like Boeing, for example. Of course, has always been been in this and companies like that. But now all of a sudden there were very cheap or free software packages available for everybody. And so people started applying it left and right, and that led to an enormous surge in the number of applications and the popularity of the field. And we are sitting in the same period now when it comes to data. You know, so in data science, machine learning, deep learning, all of those areas, you see this now too. So there's lots and lots of public domain free software packages, and people pick this up. They often use them as black boxes. You know, the software packages make it easy to play and try things out. And you see that being picked up everywhere. That, of course, comes along with an enormous surge in the volume of data that is available for people to analyze, right? So it's not the surge in data science that we're seeing right now is not just because you have this open software that people can now use wherever you are in the world. You can get libraries in R or Python or in other languages that you can use to study phenomenon. But it also comes at the same time as having a lot of data available, right? And then that's a huge difference compared to a few decades ago. But we see this growing and growing and growing. You know, it's penetrating all areas, and I've been seeing this for a very long time.
So did computational math exist before computers? It's not a stupid question. So computational math really exists because you have complex problems. You know, I mean, if you just have to calculate the acceleration of an object, there's a simple Newton formula, right? Then when you try to deal with complex things, then you need something more. Am I correct?
Yeah, so it depends on how you define computations, right? I mean, you could. I see computational mathematics as something that's been around as long as there were people that could do compute things, right? And whether that's with one person, or with 10 people, or with a computer, it doesn't really matter. So we've seen, going back centuries, actually, concepts and foundational concepts in computational math invented. I think, for example, back on the time of Napoleon, where there were people who needed to calculate what was then a very complex problem, and that was the trajectory of a cannonball, for example, that Napoleon wanted to fire at in the war that he was, you know, wars that he was fighting. And so he had French mathematicians who tried to understand how to do this. And they used approximation tools, and I would certainly see them today as computational mathematics tools. And they used to do this themselves or with their assistants and compute it. But the basic ideas that they developed for this are still some of the building blocks in computational methods now. So it's been around for a really long time. And right from the start, when people started developing mathematical models to describe phenomena, which has been going on, of course, for as long as we have a human memory, human history, people have been trying to actually solve those models too, right? So you can formulate mathematical models, and then of course you're very interested in solving them for all sorts of different situations, and that's where you start to either compute directly, and of course the more complex the problem becomes, the harder it is to find what we call closed form solutions, right? So you can express a solution in a beautiful mathematical way. And very often, when it gets a little bit more complex, you have to start approximating it, and that's where this computational mathematics comes in.
So you said that the surge came about 25 years ago, and one reason is that software became available and so on. But would you say that also that demand is increased, that because the world is more complex, then there are more problems that requires computational math?
Yeah, I mean, these are never independent developments, right? I mean, the more complex questions that people are asking become, the more attention is paid to the computational mathematics necessary to find solutions. The more new developments in computational mathematics are made. And then, of course, the immediate result of that, the more tools that are available, the more complex we make the problems we want to solve. So it goes hand in hand. So when I started in the early 80s in this field, we were solving problems that we thought were really complex. And now when I look back on it, these problems were not as complex. You know, this is now almost 40 years later, so now we can solve them fast and with relative little effort. But as soon as we, and by the way, the complexity of the problem is that you solve is determined by two things. It's the availability of the right tools that you have for this, right? It needs to be developed in computational mathematics, but also, of course, a direct result of the compute power that's available to you. And so as the compute power increases, the complexity of the problems we're trying to solve also increases, because you can bet your bottom dollar that as a computational mathematician, you're always going to push the boundaries, right? You have a faster computer, you're trying to solve a bigger problem, introducing more complexity. Mm-hmm. And what happened over time is that the problems that we were trying to solve were getting more and more complex. You know, in the beginning, to make it computationally tractable, a problem often had to be simplified. And sometimes, you know, a long time ago, when the computers were not really around, or when you had computers, but it was just a group of assistants helping you with the computations, the problems were significantly simplified, because otherwise they wouldn't be computational tractable. And so the faster the computers are, the more complexity you allow these problems to have. And a really great example is, for example, with weather modeling or climate modeling. If you look at the earliest climate models that people built, they were really quite simple models. That was not because they didn't understand what the models should really have and contain, but because there was just not the computing power available to even try to attack them, right, in that way. So now the complexity increases, and with that increased complexity, becomes a need to have better analysis tools, better computational models, and you know, also with it comes another part of this we talked a little bit before we came on now about complexity and theory, but the more details and the more subtleties we put in the models, the more complex they become, the more sensitive the solutions also tend to be to input of the models. And climate models is a perfect example, right? Over the years, the climate models have become so complex, they contain all sorts of different physical processes, and these processes all interact with each other. So the more detail we put in, the more complex these interactions also become. And what we say, and hopefully people that are listening have heard of this, the more nonlinear the response is going to be of this model, meaning that a very small change in an input parameter, for example, can lead to a very large change in what you're trying to predict or simulate. And of course, when that happens, you hit another level of complexity that makes it even harder, because now you have to really be careful about small mistakes or small uncertainties that you have around too. So most of the problems nowadays have become that we use for weather modeling or climate modeling or so many different areas have become so complex that they're really models where you're simulating under uncertainty, and that is it's both fascinating and it opens up this this huge challenge in for the computational tool development, because it requires even better tools than we've had before.
So two observations. First one, the data. So the other thing that happened in the last 20 years, certainly in the last 10 years, is this incredible amount of data that has become available. I assume that has created new opportunities, not so much demand, but just because you have so many more data, you can try to solve problems that in the past weren't even problems.
That's right. I mean, it is incredibly exciting, of course, to have so much data available to you. And then if you can actually look into the data, so that's a field in its own right, you know, how to actually mine data, how to understand what is in the data. But when you can do that, it's incredibly exciting to see what you may be able to find. And then you make observations that may not have been made before. And that, of course, challenges people then to really understand that. What are we looking at? What are we seeing here? What caused this? Can we design a model for this? This is very often the way that people work. And then once you have this model or an improvement on existing models because of all this data, of course, you can then simulate even more. So data has all the availability of the data, and I hope the audience also, you know, all of you know that this is not just the data that we have on social media, which of course everybody understands. You know, we're collecting so much data about our social media behavior, about our Amazon purchases and our Walmart purchases and our Netflix viewpoints and our tweets and our searches on Google and so on. But we're also getting an incredible amount of data nowadays through remote sensing. And I just want to put that out there as one of the areas that I work with sometimes with satellite data. The volume of data that we have now every day of the Earth and all sort of systems on the Earth is really mind-boggling. In fact, the volumes are so great that we often don't even... we can't even look at all of the data that we do have. It's so rich that there are many, many data repositories that we haven't even explored. So all of a sudden, you're like a kid in a candy store. There are all these beautiful data out there, and all of these data can bring new insights to you. And of course, that's incredibly exciting. So I totally understand why people are so fascinated by that. To give you one example, Carol, for my own background, about 20 years ago, I started working with some friends on a computer model for Monterey Bay. So Monterey Bay, close to Stanford, is an incredibly beautiful, very complex coastal ocean region that has phenomenal fluid dynamics in it. You know, it's fascinating. It's got a really deep river canyon cutting through the bay that makes the ocean floor drop off really, really fast. So you're a couple of miles out, you're very, very deep in the ocean. This is one of the reasons why we have so much wildlife also in Monterey Bay. And that makes for incredibly rich fluid dynamic structures. So we were really interested in understanding that better. And we built this software that could simulate Monterey Bay. So we ran this on large computers and we could simulate weeks of tidal motions and all sorts of beautiful motions in Monterey Bay. And we generated all this data. This is not observational data. This is simulation data, but from a virtual laboratory, if you like. And then that data just sort of sits there. We have these, I don't know how many bytes of this data, and we've never really had the tools to actually now look into the data and see what was there. But now with data mining tools that are available to us, we can go back to these old data sets and explore them. And it is as if you can now, you know, move through Monterey Bay in a little submarine, exploring parts of the bay and of the fluid flow in the bay that we've never been able to explore before. So with all the tools that we have right now, there are also a tremendous number of data sets that we've already had being unlocked because now we can look at them for the first time. So it is one of the most exciting periods you can imagine for a computational mathematician.
Right? So we mentioned software, we mentioned data, but what about the math itself? I mean, obviously 25 years ago, there was already an incredible toolkit available, you know, from algebra to differential geometry to whatever. Are you using the same methods that there were around 25 years ago? Or there's also been some invention, some mathematical, some new mathematical invention in this period?
Yeah, that is such an interesting question. And I teach on this also on campus. So there are really two possible answers. But let me give you the answer of the more mathematically inclined computational mathematicians. And that is that all the building blocks, when you really break down a problem to the actual kernels that you're using, the building blocks, those have been around for a very long time. And there was a professor, a colleague, and he became a mentor of mine when I was a student on campus, called Gene Gollop. He was the god of what we call linear algebra. And he always said, every single problem you solve, ultimately, when you break it down to its fundamental building blocks, you know, as if you have a beautiful structure made out of Legos, but you start breaking it down and you realize there are all these little Lego blocks. Those are your building blocks. They all look the same. He said, that's all linear algebra. And linear algebra has been around for a very long time. So sometimes people who look at this say, you know, the field of computational mathematics, the building blocks are all the same. But the challenges that we pose now, so it's like having all the ingredients of a nice car. You know, we know how to design the engine. We know what spark plugs look like. We know what the drivetrain looks like. We know what wheels are. You know, all of these things we've known forever and ever. But now we're asking this car, this computational model, to do much more, to be faster, to be more efficient. That is what's happening. So we don't just want those building blocks. We want to combine them in ways that give us reliable solutions. We want them to work on extremely large problems. And so that means that they have to be really fast. For them to be very fast, they also have to be suitable for the computer architecture that we have. So this is a really interesting thing. You know, I've worked on linear algebra and these sort of building blocks, computational algorithms, for a long time. But every time a new architecture comes around, so the time when we went, for example, to GPUs GPU computing became really big, it means that you have to revisit those building blocks and say, hey, is the way that we are writing these algorithms, the way that we're dealing with these, you know, implementing these building blocks that, you know, in essence haven't changed, but the way that we implement them really needs to be rethought. It's constantly shifting in that sense, the target, right? And so it's a very dynamic field still. And of course, then when you do this and when you start putting all of these building blocks together for more and more complex problems, you do see some unique challenges come up that require some more tools. Now, you can argue that if you break those new tools down to its elementary bits, it's again the same thing. But the order and the complexity in which they're put together is very different. And their interaction of these building blocks will be very different. So are there really brand new tools, sort of paradigm shifting changes in computational mathematics? There have been a few, for sure. Most of the challenges I see is really in the scaling up of the problems, you know, and the adjustments you have to make to the algorithms to deal with larger and larger problem sets and to deal with more and more sensitive systems. I can talk about this forever. But say that you're working on a climate model and you know that because you put so much stuff in this climate model, you're very sensitive to small changes in inputs. What that also means is that you're very sensitive to any errors that you're making while you're computing. So you need to understand how round-off errors that you have in any computer simulation of a system, how they accumulate, you know, as you're doing these calculations, these trillions of different calculations, and how they may impact the accuracy of your final solution. And the larger the system you have that you're simulating, the more attention you have to pay to that particular aspect. Whereas in the past, you probably didn't have to pay attention to it. So in other words, you're pushing the boundaries of what these algorithms can do. And some of the flaws of the algorithms that have been around for a very long time, for example, they lead to round of error accumulation, they become more important as the problem goes bigger because the solution becomes more sensitive to them.
I think, so as you speak, I write down more questions, but first we should step back. There's a question from Kurt that reminded me that we haven't defined the complexity. Now, he's asking what's the difference between the complex, complicated, convoluted, but complexity in mathematics is a mathematical thing. It's not just an adjective. You want to say something about complexity theory?
Well, we talked a little bit about this before, Piero. I'm very much a computational engineer, computational mathematician, and to my shame, I have to admit that I've never studied complexity theory by itself. And so, but Kurt is right, is that the way that people define complexity varies a lot. And when you look at folks in computational mathematics that come from an engineering angle, like I am, the way that they look at complexity is probably very different than the way that people who study complexity theory looks at it. And complexity is also a constantly changing target, right? It constantly shifts because once you can deal with a certain level of complexity with sheer compute power, for example, allows you to probe a little bit more, you have other complexities come in. So it is extremely difficult to answer that question, you know, how to define that. I need to actually study that much more because we've gone to a stage now also in simulation, which is most of what I've done in my life, where the subtleties that are and the complexity of the interactions of all these different processes that we're putting in big, large simulation models have become so intricate that it is actually extremely difficult to keep track of the problem itself, and where it has almost become impossible to understand the results. Okay, so I would define complexity as this limit of in our understanding, you know, this limitation. If I look, for example, now at a very complex computational model that I'm building, and I get a result when I'm predicting something out or simulating something that I do not quite understand, I can now no longer say, this is a new physical insight that I have. I need to understand first and foremost, is this something that is a phantom observation made by the model that doesn't actually exist in reality? But because the interactions between all my model components is so hard to track, it is almost impossible for me to answer that, you know, and so you have to go back, and this comes to this whole question of robustness. You know, the more complex our models become, the more we are tempted to grow the scale of the problems, and the more tempted we are to add more and more components to the problems that we are investigating, the more difficult it is actually to trust your results. And questions of robustness become incredibly important, and even reproducibility, which is a term that comes up a lot in data science, but is equally valid in computational modeling and simulations.
It's interesting that you define the complexity from the point of view of understanding the system. To me, when I think of complexity of a mathematical problem, I think more of the, is it tractable? How tractable it is?
Well, that's exactly what I'm saying, right? So we're pushing the boundary, and at some point it's no longer tractable.
So from your experience, which are the most intractable problems? What do they have in common?
We've always had at every stage in computational mathematics intractable problems, because we've always pushed the boundaries of our abilities with simulating with computing power. So as a computational engineer, a problem becomes intractable when I can no longer understand sensitivities, understand dependencies in the problem, where I can no longer probe the system really well. And very often, whether or not I can sufficiently probe has to do with the amount of computing power I have available to me. So as long as I've been in this field, people have talked about problems being intractable and us being on that edge. And it makes total sense, because as a scientist or engineer, you're always trying to push a little bit beyond. So we're always putting in more and more. And so for me at the moment, the problems that in my own field and in computational math, in the area of simulations are intractable, are highly nonlinear problems that introduce where people put together lots of different processes that happen at various scales. So let me go back to the problem of climate models, because most people have an idea of what that means. So in climate models, these problems are I would say certainly satisfy the definition of being intractable. And the reason for it is that you have, they are model something and predict something out that has a very long time scale, right? So you're interested in the behavior of climate over decades. But the components themselves have models in there or processes in there that take place at a really, really short scale. For example, now climate models have cloud cover in them. Well, cloud cover changes on the order of hours, right? And you could even argue that it is even less than hours, maybe sometimes minutes, but say it's in the order of hours. But the problem the answers you're really seeking with the climate model is decades, right? Or maybe even a century. So there is an enormous difference between scales of the subprocess that you have in them and the scale in which you're actually simulating. So we call this a multi-scale process, but you have also really long-term problems in there. For example, you know, we have cloud cover, which is very very fast in terms of time scale, right? Really short time scales. We've got very resilient high pressure systems, for example, in weather that we observe. Sometimes we see them near California, which is not good for us. We get the droughts. They're very persistent high pressure systems, for example, above large parts, really large area of Russia in the summer for a very long time. There are other very large systems that are pretty steady for several months. Okay, so we have ocean currents that also have very long time scales, but at the same time, we have these very fast processes in them too, and they all come together. Now, I already mentioned we had cloud cover. Spatially, that's also in a very, very small scale, whereas a high pressure system is at the mesoscale, so that's, you know, a much larger scale. So also in space, we have all these different processes, large scale, small scale, and they're all interacting with each other. And that is what I would say is one of the hardest problems, you know, because all the interactions also are nonlinear, meaning that these systems don't always behave the way we expect. You know, people in general are very linear in their thinking. And, you know, very often when I talk to students and I ask them, what is complex for you? You know, these are students in at Stanford that I'm teaching, say, what does a complex system mean for you? Very often they say nonlinear system. And why they say this is because as a human, we often think very linearly. You know, we push a bike, or we push a cart with a certain force and it moves a certain distance. We expect as humans that if we push twice as hard, it will move further and maybe about twice as far. And this sort of linear thinking that if I just do a little, you know, X times more, then the result should be X times more. That sort of thinking is very much, you know, in our behavior, in our way of thinking. And it's very, it's not very intuitive for us often to think about us pushing just a little bit more and seeing a vastly different result, which you can have in these nonlinear systems. And so they're not very intuitive. They're very complex in their interactions. And I would say those are the hardest problems right now. And when it comes to climate models, I don't even know how to, you know, really make them robust and reliable. So that's one part in simulation. And then, of course, there are many, many problems that are data-driven, that are really, really difficult for us. And then there are some standard problems, like there are problems that are just really tough to solve, you know, if you want an exact answer. And one of the biggest problems there that we always give our students is the traveling salesman problem, which you probably heard of, you know, that is a sort of a classical, a very, very difficult problem to solve.
So anybody who is into artificial intelligence was probably making correlations as you were speaking. So we'll talk later about AI. But first, let's finish on complexity. Kurt is asking, when you say that you need to understand the problem, or you have difficulty understanding a problem, is that how much you rely on a graphical representation of it?
Kurt, you're asking some really nice questions here tonight. As much as I can. So this is what I find also with many of my colleagues and many of the students, is that many people, they understand something visually much faster than they understand it in any other way. And so are always trying to figure out visualizations or create representations of results using graphs, using visualization, but it's not always possible. And you know, one of the big challenges really in these complex processes is how you actually look at results. And I mean, think for example about Monterey Bay. So this is or if you want climate, I mean, these are large three-dimensional domains that and they're very complex behaviors. And sometimes you go into a problem like that interested in only one thing. But if you're trying to understand the whole system, it's actually really difficult to say that will be my metric. You know, I'm going to be looking at that particular aspect in that particular location. And based on that, will I say, you know, my model does well or doesn't do so well. It becomes really, really difficult to observe and actually see in the data that you have, let alone then understand why you're seeing what you're seeing. I don't know if I make any sense here, Piero, but that is one of the hardest questions. Is you know, sometimes I say to my students also, it's easy to generate data. It's easy to predict out or solve a system and just get a solution, whatever way you present this mathematically. But it is incredibly hard and harder to now actually interpret those solutions, because the solutions themselves contain so much information. And there's therefore also absolutely a good reason why very often in the interpretation of the result, bias comes in too, right? Because we're going to be searching for for signals in the results that we're anticipating already.
Okay, before we move on to my next question, let's take both questions so we don't forget. How has computational mathematics been disruptive in industry? Is there a good example in recent history that comes to mind?
That's a really interesting question. There are many examples, but it depends on your definition of disruptive. Here is one, let's see, which example shall I take? So in data-driven decision-making, there's certainly been disruptions, and that's related to machine learning and, you know, data science, so we'll maybe come to that later. In the area of simulation, there've been incredible impacts of computational mathematics in design problems such as designing airplanes, optimization problems for logistics, for example, scheduling problems, very large scheduling problems of airlines, of ambulance services, or anything that requires a scheduling but is very 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 big problem. It has some major impacts. In the financial world, there's big impacts. I'm thinking about an area that really came up when I was a student. That was high-frequency trading. And there were several people that developed mathematical computational tools to do high-frequency trading really well. And they made a tremendous amount of money. So it was very disruptive in that sense. Computational mathematics has had really big impact in the medical field as well. So many of the tools, computational tools developed in medicine, apart from tracking data and the impact and the effectiveness of medication, has been in the area of surgery. And so there's a lot of surgeries right now that are assisted by computational models and also treatments. And one example that I worked on a little bit myself is in cancer radiation. So the whole question of when you have a tumor, say a brain tumor, what sort of radiation duration and dosage to use, and what kind of radiation to use as well. A lot of that is now aided by computational models, and we made, I think, in the medical field, great headway in that direction. Computational mathematics has also made great contributions in MRI or fMRI images, so understanding scans and so on. So image processing is really built on a lot of computational tools, so that has a great impact in the medical field. So these are just some of the examples.
Well, advertising, all these computational algorithms.
I see that that's very much the sort of data science area, right? That's so I was focusing mostly on the simulation models, but yeah, no, there've been tremendous impacts, of course, and now in terms of AI and data science, there are unbelievable impacts in all sort of different ways, because a lot of decisions are now data driven decisions, right? So this area of data driven decision making, where people use data science tools to help make decisions, whatever decisions that may be, technological developments, insurance decisions, judicial decisions, that area, of course, increases in importance all the time.
Yeah, we'll get in there in a couple of questions. First, sort of philosophical question. So you spoke about approximation, optimization, which is, to me, it's again another kind of approximation. You said sometimes it's difficult to understand the system. You said sometimes it's difficult to understand the result that you get. So, and computational math is everywhere. Now, what is the way to judge how reliable the system is when it tells us something? And climate science is the perfect example, right? There are people, not stupid people, who argue that climate science is bad science and you cannot trust the results. Why? Precisely for the reason that you said. It's an approximation, et cetera, et cetera. So then you put everything together and what you see is not a power. What you see is the limitations. So how you respond to this?
It is, I said this before, but it's one of the hardest problems in our field. And actually think, to dramatize it maybe even a little more, I think we're in a little bit of a crisis in science because of this exact question. It becomes harder and harder. The bigger the problems are we're trying to solve and the more complex they are, and I keep throwing this word complex in there, but more complex they are, it's getting harder and harder to really make them reliable and robust. And that has, of course, led to some pretty flawed outcomes, which is really affecting the trust that people have in computations. And we've seen this in data science, which, by the way, I include AI. I see data science as sort of the umbrella for everything related to data. We've seen that time and time again. It comes up almost every week when it comes to bias. You know, how can you say that your system is robust and reliable if it is clear that your system is biased? So just this weekend, there's this whole hoopla on Twitter about the auto cropping software that Twitter and other apps use for photos, that there seems to be bias in that auto cropping system. Now, I haven't looked at this myself in detail, so I can't say too much about it, but immediately people start distrusting that. And I think that in other areas that's also shown, there's been a lot of I think damage of public trust in the medical field too, with statistical analyses done and medical decisions made based on these statistical analyses that later turn out to be just not really all that reliable. So it's a huge problem for us. So then there's really two questions, Piero, is why does this keep happening? And the other is what can we do about it and how would you actually probe? And the reason why it keeps happening is because there are huge incentives for people to not just develop new algorithms or faster, you know, bigger algorithms and bigger models fast, because there are huge financial rewards for that. And you see these financial rewards in Silicon Valley, of course, straight away. The faster you can put a new app on, the faster you have facial recognition software, the faster you have a deep learning algorithm for X, Y, or Z, the faster you can make a lot of money. And saying, oh, wait a second, let's do this really carefully. Let's design this really well. Let's test it until we really understand what's in it. Your competitor will have put it on the market, right? And if you don't have people really overseeing that, which of course we don't. We're always reactive. You know, we see that something goes wrong and then we're reacting, but there is not an approval process for these types of apps. They can be put out and they can be sold and people will start to use them. So, you know, the faster you do that, the more flawed they're probably going to be. Now, it also happens in academia. You know, people are under a lot of pressure to publish and they want to be fast with this publishing. So I think in my field of simulation, people often publish too fast. They have results, it seems okay. They have something new to claim, and so they publish it without really probing whether what they see is truly right. So there is a bit of inflation of the quality. You know, what I mean is that people are overselling, right? So there is a hype, because that leads to benefits. People do it because they get something out of it, either more publications or more citations or more money. And it's really something that we have to think about very carefully. So then, you know, how do you actually probe and what do you have to do? Well, in terms of climate models, and this is true also for, of course, anything you do in artificial intelligence, it is a matter really of probing and probing and probing. And so in the Monterey model that I mentioned, or in climate models, what you would do is you would do many, many sensitivity studies, as we say, where you changing inputs a little bit to see what impact they may have on your solution. So that's the first thing you would try. In artificial intelligence or deep learning, it would be to look at, you know, what would be the result, for those of you who are familiar with this, if we trained on a different training set, you know, so we perturb the data that we're using, you know, we change it, we take a different samples and we see if we still get the same results. We take a slightly different model, maybe with different number of levels, and we see if we still get the same results. So these are really very relatively easy, but very time consuming approaches that people can use, that I put under this umbrella of sensitivity analysis. That would be the first thing you would do. The other thing, of course, you would do, and that has been done, is you build up a model really slowly. So if I build a climate model and the climate model has 50 or 100 other models sort of integrated together, all sort of models, ocean models, land models, atmospheric models, you know, you name it, and they're all sort of connected to each other, I would, of course, start with testing each of these sub-models individually, and you build this up over time. And of course, people have done this. So if you look at a climate model and you say, okay, how many sub-models are in there for all these different components that contribute to climate, each one individually will have been tested. So that's good. But now when you start putting them together, you have to now test how they interact with each other and how an error in one propagates in one of the other models. And so if you put 50 or 100 sub-models together, right, which happens in many applications, you need to understand how they interact, all of them pairwise. And then if model A and B interact well, and you can trust that, and B interacts well with C, that doesn't mean that if you put A, B, and C, the three together, it still will be robust. You know, you have to keep testing these because of these interactions between the models. That is painstaking testing. And we just don't take enough time for that.
So give us your opinion of the state of AI. To me, AI, today's AI, is a branch of computational math. And sometimes it is complex. Sometimes I don't think it is that complex. But anyway, I don't know how much you follow the rapid fire papers that came out.
Yeah, it's one after the other.
and I think some of the things you said apply really to AI. I don't want to name the specific group, but 1 year, maximum 2 years ago, there was a paper, we reached human level performance. 6 months later, the same group, pretty much the same group. Well, we didn't really reach human level performance, but now we did. And it was And then a few weeks ago again, a new paper that said, well, the previous one actually didn't really perform like humans, but this one does.
Yeah.
So what's your feeling about deep learning, data-driven artificial intelligence?
So I'm with you that I look at all those models and say they're fun computational models. You know, they're based on some intriguing ideas. But you know, I think we're really just at the start of this, because the models that we're using now are pretty crude. You know, they work reasonably well in some circumstances. You know, when we can test them, there are some applications for which it works well, but they're applied way too fast and other processes that are really not suitable for, in my opinion. And the big problem is that the vast majority of them, and people, of course, are aware, and they're trying to
understand this better, we don't actually understand what's happening inside the AI model. So this is now what you read about. This is why people start working on what they call explainable AI. And in a way that's, you know, that's entertaining, because it's sort of, you know, it's juxtaposed with the AI that we have. So now we're developing explainable AI because so far it hasn't really been explainable. Well, that's not very good, you know, as a computational person, I think, there's something wrong here. I think it is on the one hand super fun to see all these algorithms tried on various data sets and various problems, and some of it is, you know, it's fun to see the results. At times you think, wow, that's surprising, I didn't realize it would do so well. But typically when you see something on which it works well and you start trying to understand why, it turns out later that's, you know, it's understandable, the problem was not maybe as difficult as we thought. Sometimes I look at papers and I see some really good results, and I think, you know, you could have gotten the same results doing a much simpler analysis, statistical analysis. So that happens too. But on the whole, I think we're too fast, too furious, and we're not paying enough attention to it, and we don't really understand it. And you know, I'm a reviewer regularly of work, also work done in industry, where I'm asked as a contractor to come in and sort of take a critical look at what people do in their AI departments. And usually when you start probing a little bit, so when you start saying to people, okay, you've chosen a particular model of a particular size. So in deep learning, as you know, you have these deep neural networks that you set up. You have a certain number of levels in their layers. You have a certain number of nodes per layer. And if you start asking really simple things like, what would happen if we took fewer layers? So not that many, but instead of, say, I'm just making something up here for comparison, say they use a 1,000 layers, which is a relatively small problem. Say, what would happen if you used 1,050 or 980? And you'd be surprised how difficult it is for people to get similar results out. And so that's the sort of stuff that I do with them. And so what is the state of AI? I think, honestly, it's not super intelligent yet. You know, we're really just starting, but there's some really nice ideas from a computational mathematics point of view. There's some fun ideas behind this. And a lot of these ideas are not totally new. But what is new is this, the skill at which they've been applied, right? So when you actually look at the ideas in artificial intelligence, most of them have been around for some time. And several of them that are very popular were developed in statistics departments, but now they're scaled up to much larger sizes, and that comes with its own computational and design challenges. And so that's, it's interesting, but I'm not a super excited about the usefulness of these approaches yet.
I'm just curious. So right now, the buzz is about GPT-3. It's something for natural language processing. Then the neural network has 17 billion parameters. Now, parameter is basically weight. Does that, where in the scale of complex problems that sit, you know, compared with some of the problems you have been working on, like climate or whatever? I mean, it's a neural network with 17 billion parameters sounds really, really complicated. Is it? Or is it?
Well, yeah, it has. You know, many of these have, I don't know how many different parameters, and they're all being tweaked to give us, you know, a reasonable result. So you can imagine, when I first started in mathematics, for those of you listening who've done math, and we try to calibrate something, fitting exercises, I always thought that 3 or 4 parameters to fit were quite plenty to fit anything in one dimension that I wanted to fit, right? And I always feel, give me 3 or 4 parameters and I can fit anything you want in 1D. I can make it work. Is it predictive? Well, I don't know, but I can fit it, right? So this difference between calibration and prediction. So 17 billion is my mind-boggling. So that's much bigger than most of the problems I work with. That's not because I cannot design problems that are that big. I could easily do that, but I don't have the compute power. And so that's one thing that you have to realize, that in order to run problems that big, you not everybody can do it. So I mentioned earlier that we're seeing this unbelievable surge in deep learning and data science because of freely shared software, which, by the way, is fantastic. I love that. A lot of people are contributing in GitHub and people are, you know, making their software available, and that's amazing. But that doesn't make democratization of data science really work, right? Unless you're also sharing compute resources. So now the real advantage that people have is not so much the software for the algorithms per se, because like I said, that's mostly available, but the compute power needed to actually deal with these sort of problems. So if you have a problem that big, just to train it, just to see how you could tweak these billions of parameters well, you need an unbelievable amount of compute power. And so that is really only for a very select few companies. Mm. We can't, you know, at university, I can't compete with this. No. But our problems are much smaller.
Look at the QA, the last question from Ed. It's sort of in this direction. I mean, is it just the computing power or also the architecture of the computer system?
You want that to goes hand in hand. Goes hand in hand. Huh? That goes hand in hand for sure. Yeah. So and this is the thing. So you can design computer systems that will do hardware that will do a really good job for a particular type of problem, right? So that's what's happening. But often it's also the other way around, that you have, as I mentioned earlier, computer systems being developed to which you then have to adapt your algorithm. So it's when I talk about compute power, I really talk about the overall efficiency of a model on a computer, and that depends on both the hardware and the architecture and the implementation of the algorithm. And in all of these aspects, of course, there's a tremendous amount of progress being made and work being done. There are companies now also that actually specialize in building hardware specifically for machine learning applications, and in the institute you mentioned that I used to direct, we certainly see students moving into that area as well. So, but again, for these very large problems, you need very dedicated hardware. You need optimized algorithms for that hardware. So the implementation of these algorithms is not easy. So you need very good computer scientists who can help you with that. You need very good designers of hardware to make the hardware faster and the architecture more suitable for the type of problems you're interested in. And then you need good basic, you know, computational algorithms, of course, that can help you with this. So they're very large, and I think those of you listening will probably have figured out that I'm not a super fan of everything that's happening in AI or deep learning right now. I think there are some wonderful things that are possible with this, but I also think that we're overselling what it can do and overhyping impact.
That's a tradition in AI. I've been in AI since the 80s. So
exactly. Yeah.
Okay. I just noticed it's over 1 hour now that we're talking. So let me close with two sort of philosophical questions. We used to solve problems by thinking. I'm talking centuries ago, by using intuition and ingenuity. And now we solve problems by crunching numbers with computers. Did we lose something in this process, in this transition?
Well, there are many computational mathematicians who still try to do some thinking, right? And I hope I'm one of them. So we haven't totally lost it. But I do think that in this data driven area of you know, the data science and artificial intelligence, we lose track a little bit. And I see this or sometimes a lot. And I see this in companies, and I see these in teams that I observe or whose work I review, that you know, a lot of the time people say, oh, I've got a data set and I've got a black box, let's just see what we can get, without first thinking what's actually the problem that I'm trying to answer. Thinking, is the data that are available to me actually going to inform what I'm after? And so the design of the problem that actually I think is the beautiful part of science and engineering, is thinking about the right question, the right problem to solve, and then designing a good methodology to answer that question, which includes searching for or collecting or creating the data that you would need to answer that question. That is often forgotten. And I see this so often, that people immediately jump onto the data and start crunching the numbers. And just very recently at the conference, I was talking to an absolutely delightful group of students, and they're very smart and good. And they were saying, hey, we've done earthquake modeling using the latest deep neural network. And they were the first to try this deep neural network. And I asked them, well, what problem are you trying to solve, really? Why are you interested in this? And it wasn't really all that clear. And then I asked, the data that you have, is it actually rich enough? Does it contain the information you need to answer your question? And they hadn't really thought about that. So that happens more and more. Mm. In fact, you know, when you think about it, when I started in science, and now I start sounding, of course, like an old person, and a bitter old person maybe. But you would go through this old scientific method, right? Of thinking about the problem, you know, reading a lot about it based on prior information. So this is a very Bayesian approach. You would then come up with a thought or hypothesis, then you would collect the data and test it. And now you see this turned upside down. Now the data come first, right? Instead of first thinking about the problem and then bringing the data in to try to test your hypothesis. Now the data is already there from the get-go, and people look for inspiration in the data. And then they're using the data, of course, to test and predict out. So there is something not quite right about that either. That whole process seems to be a little circular in its reasoning, right? And so it's interesting also because it means we have to rethink the way we do statistics, because very often we're already informed by the data that we're using to test our statistical models. So I think we have lost something in certain areas. I think we're going to get burned. And in fact, this is to some extent already happening, right? People get burned. A lot of industries are jumping on deep learning and AI because they want a competitive advantage, and then they realize later that they don't really get as much out of it as they were hoping. And I think we'll get back to it. And that same thing happened 25 years ago with computational mathematics, and where companies got burned because they were starting to use these black boxes too often, and they realized that the engineers of that time didn't quite have what it take to really, you know, that sort of older approach, these more traditional approaches, they didn't quite have what it takes to do that sort of engineering. And then in fact some of the companies, including Boeing, then said, okay, let's help improve engineering education, because this is not the way we want to go. And I think that is actually going to happen in data science as well.
Okay, an even more philosophical questions. In ancient times, math was a vision of beauty. For the ancient Greeks, math was a spiritual experience. Now, it's a vision of complexity. Where do you find the beauty now in the complexity?
Challenges in the complexity, and for me, challenges are beautiful. Okay, so that's one answer. But there is still so much that I do and other people do in mathematics that is like what you're describing. You know, there's still so much to explore on problems that seem less complex in terms of the amount of data or the amount of computing that we want to do. And I'm working on something right now, Piero, that's really relatively simple model. It's a transport model. I'm into transport modeling a little bit nowadays. And when you look at it, it seems quite simple, but it is surprisingly difficult to understand. And so I'm still doing some of this old-fashioned mathematical detective work, if you like. But there is also beauty and complexity in that, you know, it's incredibly exciting to work on these complex problems and these big problems, because you know that if you can make a difference in this, if you can develop approaches that can make those outcomes and those predictions a bit more robust, a bit more reliable, you can make a tremendous impact. And so I think that is what inspires a lot of people.
That's a good way to end. You want to have a final message along this note for the students who are doing computational math or thinking of studying computational math?
Yes, and you know, the message which is what I always give is, don't think that you do no longer need this foundational mathematics and this foundational statistics, because now you've got, you know, data science tools. And I see this with students now. They come in, they say, we don't want to do linear algebra. We don't need it. You even see this in many of the computer science degrees. There's very little mathematics often that they require of their students, and very little statistics. And so I tell the students, hey, do study these foundations. And here's another reason for it. You know, this field of computational mathematics, including data science, is constantly changing, right? And fast, very. New algorithms are being designed, new problems are being probed, new data sets are being made available. And so the skills, if you just look at programs or algorithms that are used now, there won't be the programs and algorithms that are used 5 years from now. This will shift really fast. So you don't go to study to get exactly those skills, the algorithms that are hot now. You study to become agile. And so in order to be a really good future data scientist or computational mathematician, you need agility. And agility comes from understanding the foundational building blocks, because then you can always understand new applications. And that is what I tell the students. So do your stats, do your linear algebra, do your topology, you know, do these wonderful parts of mathematics and statistics that really form these building blocks, so that later you can always understand what other people are proposing, critique it as well, and develop your own methods.
Thank you very much. This was a very interesting conversation. Thank you for your passionate description of this field that I hope will inspire a lot of young people. I also like at one point you said you can really make a difference in this field, but you have to do it right. Thank you very much.